Hello everybody, my name is Brady and we are back with another React video, and today we're going to be checking out more from Extra History. Today we have Justinian and Theodora Part 2. Last time I checked out Part 1 and I thought it was really interesting how it was paced. This series is like 10, 12, like a lot of episodes. And I was kind of surprised at how fast that first episode was. Like, a lot of stuff I looked at it, I'm like, wait, you seem like you could have gone a little bit deeper into this stuff here. I thought you were going to spend, like, two or three episodes before we actually got into him being in charge. But no, he was in charge by the end of the first episode, which just means that we have a whole lot of material to work with afterwards if they set aside so much time for this series. I'm actually really excited based on that. It seems like there is a lot we're going to be able to work with here. So I'm excited to learn a little bit more about Justinian and Theodora as well. We didn't get as much from her. We got little details in the first one, but I'm excited to see if they go a little deeper into what her role is going to be going forward. Eventually, we'll get there. I just don't know how soon. The reforms of Justinian. I love reforms. This should be a lot of fun. Let's get this started.
Last time, we saw the Emperor Justin rise from a peasant pig farmer with a little help from his nephew Justinian. Today, we'll see what happens when power changes hands and Justinian becomes sole ruler of Rome. Turns out, a lot happens. Upon coming into his own, Justinian bursts into a flurry of action, nearly unparalleled in history. He reformed almost every aspect of the empire, trying to fix 1,000 years of bureaucracy and neglect. But he didn't do it alone. He elevated a cast of some of the most talented, most diligent men in the history of the empire to attack all the things he saw wrong with the Imperium. Unfortunately, these brilliant, hard-working servants of the empire were also some of the most corrupt, quirky, and colorful characters the empire would ever see. So today, we're just gonna work through Justinian's reforms by introducing you to these characters and what they did. First off, Justinian was a big spender. He wanted to build up the military, increase infrastructure, create monumental public works, and throw lavish games. But to do all this, he needed coin. And one of the problems the Roman Empire struggled with from its inception, one of the problems that helped bring down the West and had almost brought down the East, was tax collection. The rich would avoid their taxes, and the poor couldn't pay. And this...
So Justinian wanting to be a big spender, I guess it would make sense. Some people think that when your civilization is struggling, that's when you pull back and stop spending. But often it's the opposite. It requires greater spending, greater investment in order to get greater returns on said investment. So if he's trying to like revolutionize the Roman Empire, Byzantium or whatever you wanted, the Byzantine Empire... then, yeah, massive spending is going to be necessary.
Was tax collection. The rich would avoid their taxes, and the poor couldn't pay. And this just would not fly for Justinian. So he brought in John the Cappadocian. I mean, he even sounds like a mobster, doesn't he? This guy, John the Cappadocian, totally overhauled the tax system in the empire. He moved tax collection out of the hands of local officials. He crushed corruption within the ranks of the tax collectors. And one of his less popular reforms, at least with some segments of society, was torturing rich people until they paid their taxes.
Like, that last part was the part that's just like, oh. But that first part is the part that stands out to me. Moving... taxation, moving that job from like kind of a more localized thing to like a bigger thing. And I think that's the part that really stands out to me. A lot of the time, taxation is left to the more local officials. And it seems like local officials are typically more accepted as tax collectors. Nobody likes tax collectors, but people are more willing to accept it coming from local officials than the big, bad, far away government that they can't relate to. So I'd imagine there's got to be a decent amount of backlash that comes with this, because when it's like the United States. Like, a lot of people like their local officials way more than they like their officials in the federal government. That distant thing where they feel like, they don't relate to me anymore. That sort of thing. So maybe I'm curious to how this is gonna actually play out. This guy's made out to be kind of brilliant, so who knows? Maybe it'll work.
Of course, he was also a debauched glutton who skimmed from the taxes to feed his own perversions. Reports abound of his greed, his sexual appetite, and his boorish, slave-like treatment of his staff. Now, of course, many of these are exaggerations. After all, nobody likes the tax man, and being a more efficient tax collector probably isn't going to win you a glorious place in contemporary histories. But there are enough of these reports that I think we can assume this guy was likely running a very whistle-clean tax administration while shaking people down and engaging in some Baron Harkonnen-like good times himself.
With sounds fair.
With money needed taken well care of, Justinian also attacked the second problem of the empire, the legal code. For 1,000 years, laws had been added, changed, and overturned without anybody really collating them, rationalizing them, or really putting them together in any way that wasn't contradictory. At this point, a lot of them just plain didn't make sense. This meant that the law courts had become clogged, corruption was rampant, and justice through the legal system was simply not available for most people. Justinian planned to end this, and so he brought in Trebonian. Trebonian was one of the most brilliant legal minds of all time. In 14 months, he untangled a millennium of Roman law and had a new law code ready to publish. Then he compressed 1,500 existing books of legal decisions down to a mere 50 books set, making the law comprehensible and approachable. With Justinian's help, he then had these books ruled to supersede all previous legal decisions so that all lawyers and judges were working from the same law. He rounded out these mind-boggling feats by writing an accessible textbook for all future lawyers to learn from, and...
Okay, that's... I heard about the textbook thing. Like I said in the previous one, I had a friend who was, like, weirdly into Justinian, and, like, that's actually something that I did hear about. I find it fascinating that you could, like, override the, like... the existing legal system like that, because you have all these practicing lawyers who now have to completely adjust the way that they do things to fit this brand new system, which maybe it works because, like, clearly the old system wasn't working, but they're gonna have to, like, study up on what this new legal system actually means. You have, like, all this existing infrastructure that just doesn't fit in with this new system. So, like, that's kind of fascinating that they could do that. There must be, like, a learning curve or, like, an adjustment period.
Together, these books form the Corpus Juris Civilis, the work that today's civil law is founded on. Of course, Trebonian was also an unabashed pagan, throwing sacrilegious parties and feasts.
Oh.
He says Justinian was ostensibly cracking down on paganism. He was also utterly corrupt, or as one author once put it, every day he repealed or enacted some law at the instance of people who purchased this from him. Otherwise, of course, he was known for being good-natured, diplomatic, and only a little bit of a fop. With the Herculean task of reforming the entire canon of Roman law safely in the hands of perhaps the only man in history who might actually be up to the challenge, Justinian could finally turn his eye on military affairs.
Okay, here we go.
Conquering the West, of reuniting and recreating an empire that had only fallen some 50 years before. He dreamed of restoring Rome. But at the time, the Romans were being kicked around by the Sassanid Persians all across the southern half of the empire. Before Justinian could turn his eye west, he had to stop the Persians from taking over what empire there was left. And for this, he had one of the best generals history has ever produced. A man easily the rival of Napoleon or Alexander, though his name
really?
Is so well known. A man named Belisarius. From an early age,
sounds familiar.
He recognized this man's brilliance, and by the time Belisarius was 25, he was Magister Militum, or Theater Commander, of the East. But to talk about Belisarius, we have to talk about the Battle of Dara. At this point, Roman armies had suffered defeat after defeat at the hands of the Persians. The situation looked hopeless. Belisarius had been ordered to gather together whatever troops he can and hold the town of Dara, a small fortress town that guarded the entrance to Anatolia. If the Sassanid army got past there, they'd be in the heart of the empire. Envoys were sent from the imperial court to sue for peace, but the Persian king would have none of it. His army moved toward Dara. Reports start coming in of the strength of the Persian army. 50,000 men.
Ooh.
50,000.
Belisarius, that's a lot of people.
His troops standing on the walls of his desert border fort. 25,000 men. Belisarius wanted to hole up, to fight from behind these walls. It was the only way they'd have a chance against an army twice their size. But he knew that if he did that, the Persians would just go around him. Behind him was nothing but farmers in their fields and priests in their churches. No, he had to stop them here, so he prepared to fight. A messenger galloped up from the Persians and handed him a note. It was from the enemy commander. It said, "Prepare me a bath, for tomorrow I shall bathe in this fortress." Belisarius ordered his men. The next day, the...
What a prick. Okay, I'm fascinated in this. This, I've seen, so I've like had like some amazing feats described to me, like militarily. So like, I wouldn't be super surprised if somehow he ends up winning with such a minimal force. He has a kind of a wall to work with, but like, it's not something that I can minimize, because this is going to take some feats of military brilliance. Like, sometimes we get spoiled by some of like the big epic battles that we learn about, and we'll see like some of the amazing things that some people do, and then I'll look at this and like, oh, he beats a force twice his size, oh, what of it? And it sounds like I'm minimizing it, but no, it's just like, No, it can be done. Now I know it can be done. That's basically the difference, I guess.
The armies lined up for battle. The massive Persian army with their infantry in the center and the famed immortals on the wings. The Byzantine army lined up across from it, with their infantry anchoring the center behind a great trench they had dug on Belisarius' command, with heavy cavalry on the wings, lighter cavalry in reserve, and a small force of Huns hidden behind a hill. The Persian cavalry charged. The wings were a whirling melee of horses and men. But the center, the infantry holding the Byzantine center, just stood there behind their trench. The Persian commander faltered. Even with his numbers, he didn't want to charge his infantry over that trench. His cavalry were doing well. He would let them win the day. Once they'd routed the Roman cavalry, they could circle behind the infantry and negate Belisarius' improvised defense. And like that, the Persians pinned their own infantry, giving up their massive advantage in numbers. Then, just as the cavalry melee was swinging toward the Persians, the Huns sprang from their hiding place. All of a sudden, the Persians' right flank was in disarray. They were falling back. But no matter, there was still time to rally them. The left flank was still doing well. They'd pushed the Romans beyond the trench line. They were pursuing the Roman cavalry almost to the walls of Dara itself. But the rest of the Persian army was still where it had begun. There was a huge gap between the immortals who had chased the Byzantine cataphracts and the infantry that had never moved. The Persian cavalry had chased the Byzantines so far that they were now behind enemy lines.
Oh.
It was way too far away to support them. The Roman cavalry charged.
Get the guy.
The Byzantine cavalry rallied. The immortals were surrounded, cut off. Discipline fell apart. Each man tried to hew his way out, but one by one they fell. And now the Byzantines, having the only cavalry left on the field, knew it was there.
It feels like in the movement, like in moving to go take care of them, though, they might open up like potential weaknesses for these other forces to come in and attack. But these forces seem like their goal is to remain stagnant, like hang out there. So like, if they don't have the order to do that, then there's nothing really they can do. Also, like, they're so separated from the forces that would be over on the other side of the wall. Like, I don't even know how much they're aware of what's going on.
Their turn to ride the Persians down. No Sassanid commander would be bathing in Dara that day. This victory paved the way for peace in the East. The Empire would still have to pay dearly for it, 11,000 pounds of gold, but now the southeastern border could be secured, and Justinian could turn to the West. Now, following our pattern, this is where you might expect me to tell you of Belisarius' flaws, but by all accounts, he was a stand-up guy. So instead,
I'll
tell you about a historian who was Belisarius' legal advisor and came on all of his campaigns, a fellow named Procopius. Procopius is our principal source for Justinian's reign. By being with Belisarius, he had...
Oh, that's definitely something, a name that I heard before in a class. Maybe it was in the class I took on the Middle Ages that discussed Justinian a lot. But it could be from a historiography class where we talk about, like, historians from throughout history and, like, how events are interpreted different and how, like, we get our framing for history. I'm not sure where I heard his name, but that one's definitely familiar.
He had a front row seat to almost every major event. His work is thorough and comprehensive. It's a historian's dream. Thanks to him, the reign of Justinian is perhaps one of the best documented periods in Byzantine history. But, and here's
what's
wild, in the 1600s, in an archive in the Vatican Library, there was found a book, a hidden secret book, called The Secret History, also by Procopius. And while Procopius' official history...
Oh, this is the one I know about.
...glorious with a handful of failings mixed in, his secret history talks of Justinian as a monster. And I don't mean like a figurative monster. I mean a demonic creature that could pop off its head and wander the palace headless late at night.
Oh, for real?
Theodora as debauched and depraved, and spares no one in Justinian's inner circle. Now, today, most historians see Procopius's principal histories as highly valuable, and regard the secret history as little more than slander from some noble who was angered by the way Justinian eroded the power of the nobility. But where else will you find a secret history hidden away for centuries, penned by the same guy who served as the glowing chronicler of the reign, filled with demons and monsters?
The Vatican, man.
Under his critique,
of course.
Nothing in the reign of Justinian and Theodora.
That's where you find it.
Small. Sorry we didn't quite get to talking about the demons like I promised last time.
Aw, dude, don't worry about it. You're doing great.
A few years of Justinian's reign. Don't you worry, though. Next time, prepare to witness the demons' full fury in the Nika Revolt.
Bloodshed, yes. I'm sorry for the screaming bird. Like, these are the circumstances that we work with over here at the Social Stud channel. We'll see if I can, minimize the sharpness of his screeching in post, but I don't know if that's going to be at all doable. So thank you guys for watching. I'm going to be continuing the lovely story of Justinian and Theodora. This one was really cool. We got, nothing on Theodora in this one. This one was more to, side character stuff. Like, the other people that are definitely going to be coming into play throughout the story. So, yeah. This was a lot more ground building than the first one really was. Now that we're actually in power, now we get to build the foundation around him. Okay, so I like it. So thank you guys for watching. This was a lot of fun. Let me know what extra history series you're gonna want me to check out in the future. I'll get around to this real soon in continuing this. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. All right. I'll see you guys next time. All right. Bye.